Right, good evening. Thank you very much, Johan, and for the opportunity to be back again. So can I actually start by asking, have you had your matzah today? Right, you have had your matzah. Wonderful. So yesterday we looked at the fact that it's a command to actually eat the matzah, and today we're going to look at the part that says do not eat the leaven, and why we have got this sort of difference between the command of you have to eat matzah and leavened bread, and then tonight, why do you not eat bread with leaven in, and what would be the difference? And it is such a privilege always to share the word of Abba Father, and I really appreciate the invitation my wife and I. We did quite a bit of teaching in Pretoria where we stayed for many years. And so I was just sharing with Johan that on the 6th of May last year, during that 1 week in lockdown that we were allowed to travel, we moved down, not to travel back. And it's been a wonderful time since May of last year, to be in a little bit of a sabbatical as well. And so this is the first time that I've been actually been teaching for, quite some time, more than a year. And so I really do appreciate the opportunity. So last night we ended with this slide, that we've seen this recurring theme, the trek out of Egypt, which is basically commemorated by unleavened bread. And it is a beacon of what He has done. And because it is a beacon of what He has done, and it's because about His name and His greatness, and we saw that all over in so many different places in Scripture, actually so many, we've looked at four, but there are so many more that one can look at in terms of that the whole theme of unleavened bread and the Exodus out of Egypt was actually not about the people. It was about Him building His kingdom, and that has not yet changed. And so for us, we can grow in our faith that even though we are in bizarre times, that He will lead us through this going forward. But we have to trust in Him. And so, when we are in these bizarre times that we are in, we actually should look at it and say, Abba Father, how can we learn to trust You more and have faith for what is going to happen with us in future? How can we actually grow in our relationship with You stronger and stronger, and therefore change the perspective from actually lamenting about it by asking Him, how can we grow closer to You in and during these times? Because it's about His testimony and His kingdom, and it's not about us. So we're going to take this forward tonight and ask this question about this word leaven per se. Since this kingdom and the kingdom building is about a state of being with respect to a king, a people, a land, and a rule book, and I'm sure that after last night where you've heard it like 100 times over by now, it should be well established that any kingdom, whether a pagan kingdom, the Queen of England, an African kingdom, doesn't matter. It's those four things is what characterize a kingdom. And when, through trials and tribulations and through studying the Word, we can learn to know the King and His character. We can study His rule book, and we can start to obey His laws. We can become part of His people and find, togetherness in His people. And we also know that this land is a territory where we can actually have shalom. And that's the state of being, is to be actually in His shalom, in His absolute peace where His rules and His rule book reigns. So, The question that I'm asking there is, what was the problem with Egypt's leaven? As I've said in the introduction, yesterday we said, eat unleavened bread, eat matzah. Why then this verse? For by the strength of hand Jehovah brought you out of this place, and whatever is leavened shall not be eaten. So what is so special about the promised land's food that it must get new leaven? Because remember, the issue is not leaven. The other days of the year you can have leaven. That's not a problem. The problem is Egypt's leaven. So leaven is not a problem. It is where it comes from. It's the root of the leaven that is the issue. So you have to take, you have to get rid of this root, which is from Egypt. So you have to understand what is then specifically the characteristics of Egypt's leaven. Because that has got an important implication for our state of being, for our kingdom-mindedness. Because we cannot go into the promised land with Egypt's leaven in our backpack. So you have to leave Egypt's leaven for us to move forward. And so there's often a very big problem here. Because you have to actually separate yourself from something in order to move forward. And that is what has been basically been taught to us through this unleavened bread as well. Leave things behind that doesn't belong in the promised land. So what are they? So I'm going to highlight six characteristics of leaven from Scripture. Let Scripture interpret Scripture as we've done yesterday. So what are the six characteristics of leaven? First in Luke 13 we read, and again he said, to what shall I compare the reign, the kingdom of Elohim? It is like leaven. Oh, so it's not just, leaven is not just bad. The kingdom of Abba Father is also like leaven, which is, which a woman took, and he did the 3 measures of flour until it was all leavened. And then in Galatians 5, a little leaven leavens all the lump. The fact of the matter is, leaven is a force of influence, and it's not neutral. And I think that's the important thing that we have to recognize from the outset with respect to leaven and the six characteristics, is that it is not neutral. You cannot say, it has got no impact on me. Or you cannot say, I have grown in my maturity before Abba Father, it's okay, I can have that. You cannot say that I've grown so much that I am now some super spiritual person, or whatever the case might be. Leaven is not neutral. There's a leaven of the kingdom of Abba Father, and then there's leaven of Egypt. And we have to differentiate between the two. And unleavened bread, this feast that we are in at the moment, where is this change over of the year from the one year to the other year, we've actually been granted this opportunity to rid ourselves of the leaven of the previous year and to renew our mind and be strong and move forward with fresh leaven from Abba Father's kingdom, and leave the leaven of the past, of the previous year, and that what have contaminated us behind us. So the first characteristic, leaven is not neutral. The second characteristic, Luke 12. Meanwhile, when an innumerable crowd of people had gathered together, so that they had trampled one another, he began to say to his taught ones, his disciples, first, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. So there he defines leaven as hypocrisy. And whatever is concealed shall be revealed, and whatever is hidden shall be known, so that whatever you have said in the dark shall be heard in the light, and what you have spoken in the ear in inner rooms shall be proclaimed on the rooftops. So the first characteristic is that it is not neutral. The second characteristic is that it is hypocrisy. So let's have a look at it. Hypocrisy means, if you look at the Greek and the Hebrew, that I'm not going to go into details, just the English, to testify or to speak falsely, deceit, condemnation, inflict oppression, or to be afflicted, to hurt, or to ravish, or to depress, or to humiliate, to be morally polluted. So this hypocrisy thing is a serious thing. But it goes more than that. It is also the acting of a masked stage player. If you can think in terms of a play, that there are these, in Afrikaans the word hofnar, the fools playing on the stage with the masks on, portraying something which they are not. That's the same concept that is embedded in the word for hypocrisy. To pretend something which you are not, to be a fool in a play. And then especially it's very interesting that the dictionaries lifted it out as to be masked, to have a mask on. And I'm going to touch upon that a little bit later as well. To be pretending and masquerading falsehood. So when we are living in this, not when, because we are living in these bizarre times, truth is being masked. And we need these beacons of Abba Father to provide us with the light so that we can see His truth and walk according to that and not fall for the deception of the deceiver, which is then the characteristic of the deceiver. The adversary has got this one big overarching characteristic, and that is deceit. That is what characterizes the adversary, is deceit and deceitfulness. In other words, what characterizes him is hypocrisy. And it's his leaven. And we have to leave that behind. And you can already think, and I'm jumping ahead a little bit, but in Egypt, Pharaoh was considered to be what? A god. He was Ra. And what, and how big a hypocrisy, falsehood, masquerading as something which it is not, because he was a mere mortal, is that not? Get away from that hypocrisy, get away from that falsehood. Concealed means to grow fat or to be covered with overgrown flesh or fat, and hidden between means secret matter. So if we put it together, all these different words and what it from the dictionaries, then freely translated, it basically means, beware of the leaven of the religious leaders, the Pharisees, or the religious leaders, which is deceit with the intent to condemn and inflict hurt and humiliation by pretending and masquerading falsehood. But whatever is overgrown or covered with fat, in other words, with wealth and opulence, in other words, with glamour, anything that is then coming to us with the glamorous wealth of the nations and with that sort of intent to say, be impressed by my wealth, be impressed with my opulence, listen to me, shall be revealed, and whatever secret matter shall be made known. Falsehood covered in pompous glamour shall be unmasked in one sentence. And so Pharaoh was unmasked. He was shown to be a mere mortal. He was shown that his kingdom was made by human hands and not by God. He was taken to the cleaners, basically. And to illustrate whose God is God. And it's that message that Moses then conveyed to Jethro that we discussed yesterday. It's that message that Moses then discussed with the people later on. And that Nehemiah reminded us of. Falsehood covered in pompous glamour shall be unmasked. And it does not only speak to other people, it also speaks to ourselves. Under what pretense do we live? Under which, how big are the walls that we are building around ourselves? How big are the masks that we are putting put on ourselves? How colorful are those masks? Spiritual masks. They all shall be revealed. That's all leaven. And it's a time where we can actually rid ourselves of masks that we have put up ourselves as sort of protective barriers for ourselves. And it's a time where we can let go of those masks, those walls that we have built up around ourselves. Why is this the time? Why is this a season, the appointed time, for us to let go of those masks, those walls? Because it's a time to grow in our faith in Abba Father and to say, we don't need these masks, these spiritual masks, these barriers, these boundaries, those walls that we have built out around ourselves for our own protection. Let Abba Father be our protection. I'm going to contrast several of the statements with respect to the characteristics of the leaven with six sections out of the Sermon on the Mount. So I'm going to reflect, go frequently back to this slide that you are seeing now. The reason is very simple. Moses prophesied that the people, the nation, must look out and be on the watch that there will be a prophet like him coming. Him who has ascended and descended with the Torah. And so what happened at the Sermon on the Mount? Our Messiah Yeshua established him as that prophet prophesied by Moses, as the one who will go up on the mount and bring you the Torah. Obviously, the people listening to him has had absolutely no clue who he is. At that point in time, they were completely perplexed. He was a wonderful teacher. We will see that later. But that he was the Messiah of Israel? No, they didn't understand that yet. To them, he was a tzaddik, a holy man. Holy men come and go frequently. Holy men came and they were able to do miracles and they were teachers and so on. And to them, he was another tzaddik, another holy man. But in the way that he did the Sermon on the Mount, he established him as the prophet, as unto Moses, or that Moses prophesied will come. And he was giving them Torah. So we read about hypocrisy. What is the Sermon on the Mount teaching us? Again, you heard it was said to those of old, you shall not swear falsely, but you shall perform your oaths to Jehovah. But I say to you, let your yes be yes and your no be no. Let there be no hypocrisy. Yes is yes, no is no. Finish and klaar. And in Matthew 6, thus when you do kind deeds, do not sound the trumpet before you as the hypocrites do. And he was speaking into the leaven of hypocrisy, several places in the Sermon on the Mount. It says, beware of the leaven of hypocrisy, because hypocrisy is to pretend to masquerade falsehood. Let there be no falsehood among you. The third characteristic, Matthew 16. Then they understood that he did not say to be beware of the leaven of bread, but of the teaching of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And in Mark 8 we see the same, saying, mind, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the leaven of Herod. So leaven is also a teachings. So it's a force of influence, it's hypocrisy, but then it's also a doctrine. It's a teaching. Because that word for teaching there is the word doctrine, instruction, direction of the path. The teaching in Greek and in Hebrew two words, but the one is Yara, from where we get Torah. So which direction, which Torah, which teaching are you taking? Are you taking the teaching of Pharaoh and you're following his word, or do you take the teaching of Abba Father? to direct your path going forward. And during the time of unleavened bread, it's time to choose, basically. You've given this opportunity. That's the open season for saying, I'm going to follow after the rule book of Abba Father and his doctrine. And we're reminded of Ezekiel 44 that says, and they shall are to teach my people the difference between the set apart, the holy and the profane, and make them known what is unclean and clean. That is what should be taught. What is holy and what's profane, what's clean and what's unclean. That is what needs to be taught. Because that is then why we also started learning why we should eat matzah and unleavened bread, so that we can learn what is clean and unclean, holy and not unholy, and why we should not eat leavened bread, so that it can become a teaching tool for us onto this. On which path are we to be directed on? In other words, whose instruction, whose doctrine are we going to follow? The doctrine of Messiah? Or the doctrine of Pharaoh? What instruction are we to receive? So it's very important that this leaven, this third characteristic, speaks about doctrine. Now, this obviously is a very heavy and very big topic. I've got only this one slide on it here. But doctrine is so important. Why? Because it indoctrinates. And once it indoctrinates, what does it do? It blinds. That you don't see the truth. And so, for many years, our fathers were in Egypt, and they were slaves, and they were starting to become having a slave mentality. And they were indoctrinated to be slaves in a slave mentality. I says, no, don't be indoctrinated by that. Follow after my word. And so in this week of unleavened bread, we've got this opportunity to say, Abba Father, what mindset do I have? In my past, what has indoctrinated me that is taking me away from your perfect way? Rid me of that leaven. So let's look at the Sermon on the Mount. How did our Messiah speak into this? But beware of the false prophets, beware of their doctrine, who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are savage wolves. And then the final verses of the Sermon on the Mount, and it came to be when Yeshua had ended these words that the people were astonished at his teaching. For he was teaching them as one possessing authority and not as the scribes. Because he were in complete shalom with himself and with the Father, he was speaking from a position of authority with clear direction in terms of where he is going to go, the Torah. There was no pretense, no masquerading falsehood. He could just be calm and speak with authority his own words. And then characteristics 5, 4, 5 and 6, Paul on his very best. All jam-packed into a couple of verses here. Your boasting, which is self-glorification, is not good. Do not know that the little leaven leavens the entire lump. So immediately, Paul is reminding us that leaven is a non-neutral force. So that boasting, that self-glorification, actually becomes a non-neutral force. It becomes like person that is addicted to drugs. It becomes a drug. You must have more of this self-glorification. So don't beware of that leaven. Therefore, cleanse out the old leaven, this leaven of boasting, so that you are a new lamp as you are unleavened. For also Messiah, our Passover, was offered to us. That's the antithesis of boasting. Perfect humility. So then, let us observe the festival, not with old leaven, nor with the leaven of evil. And the word therefore evil means immoral. And immoral has got a very broad meaning, But it's basically to have a polluted mind in and be corrupted mind in all various possible perspectives that you can think of, but it is inward. You are just an immoral person, an evil person. And wickedness, the wickedness component means filled with malicious intent to do harm to others. So it's separate. Evil is when you're immoral as a person, whether it's with respect to sexual abuse, whether it is with respect to how you treat your money, how you behave in terms of your mindset. But then wickedness is when you combine it with something, say, I would like to do somebody else harm to somebody else. But with unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. And that's why we have to eat matzah. When we eat that matzah, we say we want that unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. And so he contrasts it for us. He says, with the three characteristics of leaven, self-glorification, evil, and wickedness. And that's why we do not eat of the leaven of Egypt, but eat unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. And so it's basically our prayer this week. Abba Father, teach us to be sincere with you, no pretense, no masks, no hypocrisy, no walls, just us, unleavened with the truth which comes from your direction, from your Torah, not with any other form of doctrine, so that we're not indoctrinated by other teachings, but you. Because you are the way, the truth, the light. And it's you that we are after. And so we can compare these three as well with the Sermon on the Mount and see how that is reflected on the Sermon on the Mount. And it starts in Matthew 4. We always say that the Sermon on the Mount is Matthew 5, 6, and 7. Well, actually, the chapter numbers and verse numbers came a little bit later. So the actual teaching starts in the last couple of verses of chapter 4. And Yeshua went all Galilee, in the Galilee, teaching in their congregations and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, which we discussed yesterday. So the good news of the kingdom. There is no such thing as a gospel of salvation. It's the gospel of the kingdom. Salvation is part of it, but it's not the end. As we discussed yesterday, Passover, unleavened bread. Unleavened Passover is, yes, thank you, Abba Father, for sending your son. But now, the journey starts of building the kingdom. And so he started this journey, and he says he was proclaiming the good news, the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every disease and every bodily weakness among the people. But when he saw the crowds, he went up on the mountain. And when he was seated, his taught ones came to him. And having opened his mouth, he was teaching them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are the humble. Because this is the kingdom of heaven. As opposite to the boasting, the self-glorification, everything that is then the leaven of Egypt that Paul also warned against. So because this is the kingdom of heavens, to the poor in spirit, the humble, like he was, the perfect example of humility up until the cross. So leaven, in summary, is a non-neutral force of influence. Be therefore very careful which leaven you eat. And that's why we cannot put Egypt's leaven in our backpack and move forward. We have to leave it behind. Hypocrisy, being morally polluted while masking the true identity and the truth and masquerading falsehood and concealed in the dark. And that which is concealed in the dark, or to act in the dark, or to have dark thoughts, that's the definition of the occult. To do something in the dark with the intent to manipulate things. 11, teaching dogma, philosophy, and then pride, haughtiness, and boasting, the self-glorification, the evil, which is the depravity of mind, and then the wickedness, where we would like, or which represents then the intent to do harm to others. And so that's why we don't eat the leaven of Egypt. Because we don't want to associate with these things. But we realize that leaven is a force to be reckoned with. And so we cannot just say, okay, I realize that those five things are bad and I don't want to do it again. Abba Father in his great wisdom gave us this teaching tool for 1 week in a year to say, now eat matzah and think about this and don't do it and come in this pattern. So that you can rid yourselves from those things. And as you rid yourself from those things, what happens? The kingdom is being built, establishing his truth in sincerity. And so Egypt's leaven, that state of being, that mindset, we can actually think of so many examples, but the one is Joseph, in a sense. Because what? His brothers didn't recognize him. He was completely assimilated. His children was completely assimilated. So then this sort of the proverb there, like if he walks and quacks and act like a duck, then perhaps you are a duck. So don't follow that force of influence. Filled with falsehood and deceit, up to the point that they were using sorcerers, Pharaoh using sorcerers to basically help him govern and manage his kingdom. Let us not go to sorcerers or any other form of similar evil-minded person for help. The help that we need is in the word, sincerity and truth. Pharaoh was seeking self-glorification to the point of being a god. Morally polluted with a deprived mind and the intent to hurt others. We do not wish to be under that law. We discussed that yesterday briefly. Under which law do you want to be? We do not want to be under the law of Egypt. And so we're given this opportunity to rid ourselves from its leaven. There is this remarkable imagery that's given to us with this journey through the Sea of Reeds. We know that from Exodus 44 that we've just read, we learned that we should be taught what is the difference between holy and unholy, and clean and unclean. Egypt was unholy, and the people were defiled by being there. So they needed a wash. So they go through the baptism. You can also see it as basically as an umbilical cord to a new birth, starting afresh. And so this feast, this unleavened bread feast, is actually that opportunity for us to rid ourselves of those things that we've just mentioned on the previous slide. Those things from Egypt that sort of comes and sits on us. By eating matzah and by fixing our mind on it and say we will eat this matzah, this unleavened bread, the bread of sincerity and truth, and rid ourselves of the leaven of Egypt, that we find that we are renewed in our mind. We are renewed in our relationship with our Father, as we then enter into the next, in the year that lies ahead. And so as we transition the year, we are reminded that we were defiled by the previous year's activities and everything that happened with it. And we needed a wash. We needed to be cleansed, spiritually cleansed, mentally cleansed, refocused, recalibrated. And isn't it amazing? Kindness, grace, whatever you want to call it, by our Father to grant us unleavened bread at the beginning of the year, to gain this fresh perspective on our state of being. We don't want to be in Egypt. We don't want to sit with that leaven in our backpack. We don't want to go into this next year with that stuff carrying that around with us. And so unleavened bread is therefore this opportunity to say, Abba Father, we have sinned. We are carrying this nonsense with us. But we don't want to carry it with us. We want to be partakers with you in the building of the kingdom and help us to get rid of this leaven. And then yesterday I've referred to this remarkable verse. I find it stunning at least. In Exodus 14. And Moshe said, so there's this side of the Sea of Reeds, eh? Where they haven't passed through yet. The Sea of Reeds is before them, and Egypt is behind them. And Moshe said to the people, do not be afraid. Friends, do not be afraid. Trust in Abba Father. Because look at this. He says, stand still. Now, unleavened bread, the word is yatsah, to come out. That word there is yatsap. It gets a B, a bet. And a bet in the Hebrew alphabet is a house. In your going out, be unmoved as a house built on the rock. In your going out, have faith like a house built on a rock, unmoved. Stand still, be unmoved, and see, ra'ah, have insight. That's what's important. Have insight. Et, that massive word, Aleph Tav. The deliverance, the word that's standing there is Yeshua. And see, Yeshua of Jehovah, which He does for you today. In your going out, in your trek out of Egypt, in your transition by leaving the leaven behind of Egypt, going forward, be unmoved in your faith, because see, have insight, see the Messiah of Yeshua, of Jehovah, which He does for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you are never, never to see again. Jehovah does fight for you, and you keep still. I think if we can start a year with this, because this is no doctrine, this is scripture, just reading, then whatever doctrine comes along, whatever teaching, whatever hypocrisy, whatever evil, whatever wickedness, whatever leaven, stand still, do not fear, and see what I'm going to do in your midst. That's trust in our God, and that will grow the kingdom. So unleavened bread is a time of preparation for each person to discern the leaven in his and her life and by his hand trek from it in faith going forward. So I'm just having reflecting on the five characteristics and ask questions. Are we assimilating? The accusation made to Esther, Esther's people, by Haman to King Ahasuerus was, there is a certain people scattered and dispersed among the people in all the provinces of your reign, whose laws are different from all people. So that was the accusation or why they had to be murdered, because they did not assimilate. So are we going to follow in the footsteps of our fathers and say we're not going to assimilate? Even if there's a Haman that says, there's people that's different, so let's murder them. The words of Moses to his people, with the Egyptians behind them and the Sea of Reeds in front of them, saying, as you see them today, you will never, never see them again. We know the story. Haman died on his own gallows. So let's take courage from the book of Esther and not assimilate, but have faith. Are we operating in dark and filled with falsehood and deceit while growing fat? He says, no, not me. Well, unfortunately, our fathers before us in Deuteronomy 32, but Jeshurun grew fat and kicked. Even Jeshurun. Jeshurun, which is this word that has been used only once in the scripture to express Abba Father's passionate love for his people, saying, but you grew fat and you kicked. Even his people. So let us not be haughty and think, no, it can't be us. So have we grown fat? 2 years ago, Grant Luton was here in your midst, and I'm borrowing this slide from him. I've just added some visuals to it. And he made this comparison between the bodily senses and the spiritual counterpart. I cannot but help to see the correlation of what is happening currently. Our hearing, our smell, and our touch are being impaired. And thus, our ability to, there's an attack on our worship, an attack on our ability to discern the truth, and there's an attack on our conscience, so that people, the world becomes morally polluted, corrupt, operating in hypocrisy and deceit, filled with the leaven of Egypt. But we shall not fear. We know what is happening. It's not that we're blind to it. We just don't fear it. We don't fear the spirit behind it. Because of Abba Father. Are we seeking self-glorification? Deuteronomy 9. It is not because of your righteousness or the unrighteousness of your heart that you go to possess their land, but because of the wrong of these nations, and Jehovah your Elohim drives them out from before you, in order to establish the word which Jehovah swore to our fathers, Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov. It's not about us, it's about the covenant. I was so stirred in my spirit when Johan prayed and says, thank you for the covenant, when he started this evening. It's not about us. It's about him establishing his kingdom in fulfillment of the covenant. We're partakers of it. So there's no place for us to seek any form of self-glorification. Are we morally polluted and have a deprived mind? Even our fathers, a twisted and crooked generation, has corrupted itself. Strong accusations against our fathers. We are no better. Let us look into ourselves and ask our Father, what leaven do we have, and can we rid ourselves from that? Are we filled with malicious intent to do harm against others? Our Father says, vengeance is mine. It's not ours. Vengeance is his, because it's his battle. It's his fight. So vengeance is his. And so we see these elements of unleavened bread, those characteristics thereof everywhere. And we can actually ask our Father in the remaining part of unleavened bread to help us. Those words of Apostle Paul, we eat the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth and crave after that matzah. And when we eat the matzah this week, say, Abba Father, with this matzah we seek sincerity and truth, and your healing for our pain. Because we don't need a mask before him. We can be us, his people. So how do we see this in the Sermon of the Mount? Blessed are those who mourn, because they shall be comforted. That phrase comes from Isaiah 61. I'm not going to read the entire verse, but what it is saying is, what is the mourning about? It's mourning for souls. people that's lost. So in this time, we also have this massive opportunity to pray for people that's lost and to mourn for them, because they shall be comforted. How shall they be comforted? When people turn to our Messiah, like Jethro did, and be comforted. Somebody has met their Savior. As we have concluded last night, my final slide. Our Father who is in the heavens, let your name be set apart. And suddenly, when we think about hypocrisy, when we think about falsehood and deceit, when we think about leaven, let your name be set apart. Absolutely unblemished. No leaven. No falsehood. Pure and clean. Let your kingdom come. Oh yes, and we can be partakers thereof. Actually, it's your desire that the kingdom be established on earth through us as your people. Let your desire be done on earth as it is in heaven. We know that your desire in heaven is absolutely pure, sincere and truth. Let that desire be also our desire here on earth. And give us that bread, that daily bread. Yes, a physical means to live, but the ability also to see, because we will live by every word from His word, and not by bread alone. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And as we forgive our debtors, what do? We basically remove the shackles from them so that they also can live in freedom. As we say, we don't want to carry the leaven of Egypt with us. We want to have the unleavened bread of Abba Father. We want to live free with this sincerity and truth and leave this baggage of Egypt behind. And as we forgive others, we allow them to also enjoy that freedom. And forgive us not our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into trial, but deliver us from the wicked one. As you have seen these Egyptians today, you will never ever see them again. Because yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you, Abba Father, that we can just be humble tonight by the power of your word, and know that you have in all detail looked at everything, and it's by your kindness and your immeasurable grace that you've said, my children, my beloved, start this year by eating matzah, seeking the sincerity and the truth, and leaving Egypt's leaven behind you. And Abba Father, I pray for this congregation, every person here, they will really be encouraged and strengthened to stand still in their faith, be grounded in their faith, and trust you irrespective. And thank you, Abba Father, that we, our hope is not futile. It is not in a puff of air, but it is in the rock of our salvation. Let your kingdom come. Amen.